Lisanne Skyler from Brillo Box, 3 cents off. We've also got Francisca Alegria from And the Whole Sky Fit in the Dead Cow's Eye. Oh, she might still be in the bathroom. Sorry, Matt Tyrnauer from Jean Nouvel Reflections. And Lewie Kloster from Legal Smuggling with Christine Choy. And Francisco will join us when she's out of the restroom. Oh, you guys are so far away. No. That's better. So just out of curiosity, how many of you in the audience have seen the films of these three fabulous filmmakers? Fabulous. Okay, great. They didn't all screen in the same program, so it's okay if you didn't see them all. So just by way of introduction, I'll open by asking you guys how you got the idea for your films, and you know, as you do that, maybe you could just give the audience a brief description.
Okay, cool, I'll start. I'm Louie. I made Legal Smuggling with Christine Choy. It's an animated doc in the doc program, screening one last time tonight. So I got to meet the subject of my film by signing up for her class at NYU. I'm a current student, fourth year undergrad. And she was teaching documentary. So she's an odd character. She's 65. She'd kill me if I say that. Years old, and she's an Asian immigrant, and she's addicted to cigarettes, and she refuses to smoke anything else but Benson & Hedges 100s Deluxe. And she started class one day by saying, "I just got home from Toronto because I needed to buy my cigarettes from duty free." And I filmed it all. And I approached her after class, I said, "I'd love to edit that." And I watched the footage, and it was not good, even though she is a cinematographer with a film that has been nominated for Academy Award before. And I said, I've never animated before, but I'd love to give it a shot. She said, "Take the summer." So I spent a summer animating with my little brother, Noah. And then the film chronicles that Toronto experience.
Great. More on self-taught animation later. That sounds interesting. And Matt, how about you?
In the past, I've written a lot about architecture, and I thought it would be nice to make a film about architecture. And through some associations, I met Jean Nouvel, who's a Pritzker Prize winner. And architects, very senior in his career, but architects really don't get rich and famous till they're about 60 usually. And Jean is, I think, at the height of his career, about to open the Louvre Abu Dhabi, which is a museum on the scale of Bilbao, Frank Gehry's Bilbao. And we had the opportunity to start to follow him around building these massive projects, and decided to make a short about him covering a particular through line of his career, which is the use of the musharrabi, which is a traditional Arabic kind of screen that he adapted for a building in Paris, the Arab Institute, which was one of his first buildings, and he uses it in a dramatically different way in the Louvre Abu Dhabi. So that's the point of, that's the through line of the film, and that's how it's structured.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lisanne, and I made Brillo Box. And that is a short film about the path of an Andy Warhol Brillo Box that my family once owned, and how it went through twists and turns and grew in value. And I guess I've always been interested in stories about economic cycles and how economic cycles impact us personally. And I was also very interested in a time in my family's life when my parents were really entrenched in the art collecting scene of the 60s and 70s and 80s. And so I started kind of interviewing my parents to see if they would be characters on film and how they would feel, you know, on film. And then what happened was the Brillo Box they once owned came up for auction and sold for $3 million. And so it became the perfect sort of setting to explore a story about how things change in value and how that impacts us.
And Francisca, the question was just how did you get the idea for your film, and to give the audience some background on it?
Okay. So my film is a short in the narrative program called And the Whole Sky Fit in the Dead Cow's Eye. So this was my Columbia University thesis film. And I worked on the script a lot, and I wanted to tell a story set in the Chilean countryside. I'm from Chile, and I feel very connected to little villages because they resemble the places where I grew up, where my grandparents are from. And more specifically, I think the story itself kind of like started building itself with like three main images when I thought about this landscape and these people who inhabit it. And so the first element was a tarot card. Someone was reading my cards, and I only go to one person, not just a random person. But so in that card, one of the characters of the film now appeared and told the story of a man that came back to his town, or came back after a long time gone. So that was like a first element that came to me, and I was like, okay. Then the second element was a news that I read in a Chilean newspaper that said 55 dead cows due to lightning bolt. And that struck me, you know, like it really hit me. And I was like, I need to include this, because what happens when these kinds of news reach to these very superstitious villages? Will people believe that it's something else, something beyond? Or will they just take, you know, that it was just nature? Or so that was the second thing. And the third element was a very kind of like personal moment that I had with one of my grandmas. And the protagonist is an 85-year-old woman from the countryside. So so one of my grandmas, who's that same age, she was telling me a very sad kind of like experience that she went through. And for the first time in my 31 years, I saw her cry, and her tears didn't stop. It was as if she had like a very big, like millennial pain almost. Mm-hmm. And that, I needed to do something with that. So this kind of like three elements started, you know, kind of like working in my head, and it was a rewriting process of like a year, I would say, more or less.
Well, so I'm curious about, just to talk about the short form in general, and to start with Matt and Lisanne, because you've both made very successful feature films. What about these stories? How did you decide to tell them in the short form, and how did they come to be the length that they were, and what brought you back to a short form after making a feature or two?
Money. no, sort of kidding. For documentary, my favorite form is cinema verite and the follow doc, kind of not scripted and not narrated by a voiceover narrator. I think that's the most beautiful form of documentary. It was very much in fashion in this country in the 60s and 70s. The Maisels are the, you know, one of the great practitioners. Sort of fallen out of fashion a little bit, but I like to do it whenever I can. This had a central character to it, so it lent itself to that. So it was a great opportunity to follow a very brilliant man through a little sliver of his life and show his process, and that's the other point. It's a process film. The 15 minutes that it is, I thought was a reasonable length, and I think that things that go on too long are unfortunate. So I think in short form, it seemed like 15 minutes would be good, and we could say and show what we needed to in 15. It's in terms of a 90-minute feature versus 15, they're different animals. I think the beauty of editing a doc, I think, which I wouldn't have realized when I first started making documentaries coming out of journalism, was you figure out what your thing is, and when you figure out what it is and how it works, that's what it is. And that might sound amorphous and simple, but that just means you have to take everything away that's not servicing the story of your film. And the more you take away, probably the better your film is. So with a short, I thought that was also an interesting exercise. The that kind of brevity is the soul of lingerie, I guess, is what Dorothy Parker said, but being brief is good.
There's no lingerie in your film, if I recall.
Alas, no, you don't want to see Jean Nouvel in lingerie, I don't think. That's a different movie.
Well, since you mentioned brevity, I mean, Lisanne, your film, it's 40 minutes, but it doesn't feel like 40 minutes. And I think once upon a time, 40 minute might be kind of like this no man's land of length, right? Your short should either be under 20 or a feature. But you sold it to HBO, you found a home for it. So obviously it's successful at its length. How did it come to be that length?
Well, I also, the economy is a sacred rule in filmmaking. I think Walter Murch talked about, you want to say the most with the least, you know? And it was the first cut that HBO saw was 52 minutes. And we kind of looked at it, and it was like we thought we could pack, you know, reduce it to its more essential story. And so I was really drawn to the economy of trying to pack it all in into 40 minutes. But also stylistically, I think there are things you can do in short filmmaking that are harder to do in a feature. I think some of the stylistic explorations in Brillo Box would just not work in a 90-minute film. It's kind of about compacting things. So
you have more freedom?
Yeah, I think there is a little more creative freedom. I had made a lot of observational documentaries. I was raised on Frederick Wiseman, very cool observational films, and I this was the first film where I really have a voice in it, and I'm a character in the film, and I wanted to do some break with some of the conventions of documentary in it, and I think the 40-minute short length was a perfect venue for that.
Did you always know you were going to be a character in the film?
No. So when I started the film, I was a little bit like, if you guys saw Adaptation and Nicolas Cage just wants to make a film about flowers, you know, I was like, I was him. I just was obsessed with the Brillo Box and all the cultural conundrum of the Brillo Box. And it to me, it was the character. And there were so many cool things, and just Warhol, and just all the twists and turns of Warhol's career and what this Brillo Box had went through. So it started much more objective, and my voice was just like in cards. It was very minimal. I my previous films were always very minimal, and so it had like this leanness. And it was Sheila who said you should. Sheila Nevins, who is the executive producer of the film from HBO, and she said, "I think you really need to." And Lisa Heller, also the senior producer, they both said, "I think it's time for you to tell your story." And that was really I think what made it what it was.
Yeah. Did you have any reservations about sort of turning the camera on your parents' marriage in that way?
Well, it didn't. It began not as personal as it became. But once my parents started talking about, because the film deals with their different views on art and how art was handled in our family, and their different ways they handled it. And I didn't, in the sense of my parents, they appreciated art, but they also appreciated a good story, and they were really great storytellers, and they had great stories to tell about being in Soho when it just started, and all the just stories about people coming to our home and not understanding what we had in our walls. So they were very collaborative in that sense. But it was, you know, and then when I would get notes and it would be, you know, the suggestion would be it should be a little more personal, I would just talk to them about it. Mm. So we kind of all went through it together.
Look who's joined us. This is Nadav Lapid, whose film, I've got your film here, From the Diary of a Wedding Photographer, also screened in the narratives section?
In the international.
In the international. Welcome. Thank you.
Sorry for being late.
That's okay. Do you just want to say a quick introduction about your film and where the inspiration behind it came from?
Hi, good evening. Well, it's a 40-minute film. It tells the story, the adventures of a wedding photographer, who gets married with one bride and kills the other. Where did it come from? Basically, it came from my own experience as a wedding photographer. Many years ago, when I was studying in film school, but then again, I mean, it contains reflections about love, intimacy, living in couple, possible, impossible. I mean, I guess things that more or less all of us as human beings share. So, it's also based on my experience as a human being. Mm.
And I asked Lisanne this, but how did you come to make it 40 minutes? I mean, that sort of previously would be thought of as kind of like a dead zone of a time period for a short, but it's, I think that, you know, the categories are expanding.
So, I mean, I've done before two feature films that were here in the film festival, and I'm working now on my third one. It's going to take place in Paris. Actually, I couldn't tell what will be the duration of the movie. Like, the movie was the script was, I think, around 12 pages. So I guessed that it. I mean, I couldn't care less, but I guessed that it would be around 15 minutes. Then it became 40 because there are like very long sequence shots. Mm-hmm. Now my new script is 120 pages, so I guess it will be 5 hours film. I mean, I think that for me there was something liberating because you know when you work on feature films, and I think maybe it's the same in the US, but mainly it's even worse in a way in the European system. Things take a lot of time. Since it's public money, you have to face all sorts of committees, you have to justify your choices, you have to talk about your motives. I think it's the less creative possible thing, because I think that when you demand filmmaker to understand everything, you ruin something wild and unconscious. And since this process takes time, even if things are going well, So I really enjoyed this liberty, this freedom of making something which was in a way much more spontaneous. And you know, I think that in a way there's something problematic for me even in talking about duration, because we talk about duration because of, I mean, no one would ask the poet, why didn't you write this poem as a novel? I mean, come on, it's five lines. Couldn't you do it 200 pages? I mean, it's a strange question. And I think that in a way, it would be really pity to adapt the criteria that if it's hard to make money out of it, then it shouldn't be done. It's a totally external criteria to cinema, although we know cinema is grounded in materialistic life, but I think the interesting thing is to understand how do you deal with such duration. I mean, I think that a lot of short films, for example, I also teach cinema, a lot of short films suffer from this attempt to condense a feature film into 15 minutes, into 20 minutes, and I can tell that, for example, I treated differently this short film after doing feature films. I mean, it gives you a different perspective. I mean, you understand that you should treat differently time. To resume it, for example, I think that I cut out of the film all the explanations. When you cut the explanations and you stay only with the results. Mm-hmm. And if you take a feature film, you'll cut the explanations, you'll get a 40 minutes result.
Yeah. I wanted to ask Francisca and Louis, you're recently out of film school, and Louis is still in school. So for you, I mean, you guys haven't made features yet, but how do you hope that these shorts will inform your future work? And I know, Francisca, you've got a feature in the works that's sort of, it is related to this short. So yeah, just talk about that a bit. We'll start with you.
I made the short not thinking of, you know, like what I was gonna do next in terms of the relationship between the short and a new project. But for me, it's just in the nature of the film that I'm working on in Chile right now. I had to keep talking about the world that I have in the short, which is like a mixture of magic realism and a bit of fantasy, even, because I think that my literary kind of like influences inform a lot the world or the atmosphere that I create. So just like naturally, the feature that I'm gonna make next year in Chile, it's gonna live within the same world. So the characters will be very similar, but I couldn't tell like the same exact story. But that the short has helped a lot Once I understood my characters in the world, now I can kind of like finish that script in a much more, I would say, lucid way. Mm. And on the like another thing that I found also, you know, with it's kind of like difficult to get out of school. I graduated in May, and to see what's next, because as directors sometimes we don't make the choice of what's next. It's who is interested in your work, so that you can, you know, because we're not the carriers of the money, you know. Mm. But on another side, I was approached thanks to the short by American producers, and now I'm developing a film for the US, which will be in a way similar to the shorts world, but set here in this country, and I'm taking kind of like the elements of this culture as well. So I'm kind of like bringing my narrative and mixing it with I don't know what's happening here, with characters here, and I'm actually co-writing it with a good friend of mine and a very talented screenwriter from Colombia as well. She's right there. So she hasn't graduated yet, but it's difficult, I would say, to kind of like get out of school and start working in the real world. I think that you have to just know how to put your work out there, and if you have like solid, you've worked a lot out of school, then you just kind of like have to start, you know, meeting people who would have your same sensibility and believe in your crazy ideas. Yeah.
Lewie, how do you think this short will inform your future work?
That's a cool question, because a lot of short filmmakers, the shorts that they create inform their features for sure. And the fact that when you're working with a short, there's this thing of contrast where you have to instill clarity in a film, especially if you're going to make a comedy like mine is. Because comedy is all situational, especially from the screwball comedies of the early days of filmmaking. And it's about time we resurrect that. And so clarity is key when you're making a comedy. And in that, you can, you have a little more, oh gosh, what am I saying? Anyways, the contrast of creating two sort of opposing forces in a film. Like, so in my film, it's all animated, hand-drawn, so we wanted to, Christine, the subject of the film, if you meet her in reality, she's the most animated, cartoonish character you'll ever meet. But in the film, she's represented as this like very stark, black and white, almost drawn with charcoal, hard pencil character. And then the film that she lives in behind her, the background of the film, which is more of like the Law and Order based system that she lives in throughout the film, is portrayed as more comedy cartoons. And it's like all this cardboard cutout and crayons and stuff. And yeah, once you establish sort of like the roles of each player in the film, and you sort of bring apart and to highlight either their differences or what they're up to or what their goals are and their games are, that's cool. And then as well as in the short, you have to establish all the major plot joints so quickly, so you have less room to play. And in doing that, you know, the proof is in the pudding. It's with the filmmakers who are alive and making films today, who have started out with shorts, they're doing very well. And if you're able to hit those plot joints in such a short amount of time, it's very, very difficult. And you're able to, you know, jettison your career out there, and it's super cool. Can't wait for it.
Well, do you think you'll continue to do animation?
Yeah, so this was the first time we had animated, me and my brother, and since we realized people think it's a pretty cool movie, we've sort of run with it, and we've made about two or three more since, and we just love every second of it, either 2D or this flickering image style of 2D that we have, where we use like a pair of scissors to cut out a drawing that we made, and then we shoot it on green and layer it in post. It kind of gives this like really shimmery 2D fun feel to it. And it's just sort of relating back to how animation felt before the digital age claimed king, and people haven't fallen out of love with it, which is super cool. Yeah.
For Lisanne and Matt, I was wondering if there are any, you know, I think that when you're making a documentary, often the subjects can, I know with Valentino, you had some issues where he wanted to pull out of the film a couple times. He played this sort of cat and mouse game. Were there any anecdotes about where you thought maybe, you know, you weren't going to get the shot or someone was got cold feet?
With Jean Nouvel, he's a temperamental artiste. He was much more welcoming than we thought, actually. I can't think whether he decided he didn't want to be filmed. I mean, he didn't. Valentino melted down on camera and actually said he quit the film on camera, and that was in the film. Nothing approaching that happened. And this is a different kind of much more meditative film. I think I've had a lot of, I have like a PhD in very difficult people as subjects. And it's interesting dealing with that. I think the thing I could say that might be interesting is the whole subject of a documentary filmmaker becoming a kind of part of the subject's life in a kind of transference way. So psychological way of talking about it, or if you're doing a couple, the Valentino film I did was about a couple. And I became a part of their sort of marriage in a weird way. You become a pawn in these people's lives, and they use you, you know, in their little games in their life.
Well, you did cite Grey Gardens as an influence. So
Grey Gardens, you got what you deserved. Grey Gardens is a huge influence. Yeah, absolutely. And the Valentino film, my nickname for it was Gay Gardens, actually. But you're in
That's not in the press materials, I take it.
No, this is my private name. this is really interesting, though, in how you deal with the subjects and getting in their lives and how they use you and manipulate you and how you, frankly, manipulate them, maybe. And then how you try to be fair in making the film. That, I think, is really fascinating and always fun to look at when you see a movie and try to see where the filmmaker is in. You don't want to be too in, and you don't want to be drinking the Kool-Aid, so to speak, and self-censoring yourself. I think that's the really important thing. And I'm happy to say with Jean, he gave no comments editorially at all and hadn't seemed to have no problem with the film.
Great. Lisanne, I know you shot it at a Christie's auction. Was that tough to get access?
No, actually, people asked that, and Christie's, I just called, and I asked, and I told them the story of my family, and they said, come. Oh. They were just incredibly kind, and then they said, would you like to interview Laura Paulson? She's our Warhol expert, and I said, that would be amazing, and so I tried to prepare for this, you know, interview, and when I got to the interview, I found out that not only was Laura the person in my footage who actually was representing the collectors that actually acquired the box that night of the auction, which is kind of the like key point of the film. She was also friends with one of the people in the provenance of the path of ownership that the box followed. So I went into this interview thinking that it was going to be very, you know, just the facts, and it ended up being very emotional and very much about just that understanding we all have, and that someone from Laura's perspective, she's an expert and understands the art world and Warhol, but also how sometimes people part with things and then they change, their feelings change about that later. That's a very common thing. So it ended up being a very emotional kind of interview. Yeah.
All right, we're going to open it up to you guys for questions. We just asked that you use a microphone if you have a question. Is anyone dying to ask something? No? Come on. All right. Yeah, here, she's bringing you one.
Thank you. I'm interested in what your next project is gonna be.
My next project?
Yeah.
My next project is, as I said, it's a feature film. It's a film that is going to take place in Paris. I'm Israeli. It's a film about an Israeli guy who moves to Paris in order to stop being Israeli and becoming French, or to heal himself from the Israeli disease. Yeah. Thanks.
Other questions from the audience? Oh, yes, sir. The microphone's coming to you.
Yeah, I'm just wondering how you all sustain yourself. I mean, you make a short, it probably has very limited life. I mean, do you aim for film festivals and then, like, let's say Sundance, you got 8,000 submissions and then maybe 100 slots. I mean, how do you keep going? Is that what, I mean, do you, is it like a lotto thing? Or are you preparing? I mean, what is it? Or just desperation or something?
Well, Lisanne, you want to start? You look like
that's a profound question. How do you keep going? You know, how do you keep going in the arts? Is a really
filmmaker artist.
Yeah, no, I mean, you know, we all go through ups and downs, you know, in this business. And I've supported myself as a screenwriter. I did that for a while. I was going back and forth in documentary and fiction, and I sustain myself as a film professor. I teach at University of Arizona School of Theater, Film, and Television in Tucson. And through teaching, I began that 10 years ago, and part of why I did that was because I felt that I would be more free as a filmmaker, that I wouldn't be thinking about the marketplace as much. And that led me to this film that I have here at the festival. But in terms of the audience, I think, you know, it's interesting, 10 years ago, we'd have a very different conversation about short films, because it was always, you make the short, then you've got to make your feature. But it's really important to think about the fact, think about how we consume media now, which is very different than we did 10 years ago. We don't go to theaters as often as we did, and we are much more seeing things online and seeing things on Netflix and turning things on. And then if it's not that interesting, we might not watch the whole thing. So I think that I would definitely encourage filmmakers in the room to think about how the short format relates to how distribution is working, you know, right now. So many more opportunities, and there are opportunities to I hate this word, but monetize, you know, your short films just by being really entrepreneurial with what you do with, you know, Vimeo and Amazon and all these things. So it's just it's a new world, I think. And length today means something different than I think it did when many of us were starting.
Does anyone else want to comment on how sort of the changing distribution and digital media has possibly changed the way you think about shorts or film?
I don't know anything about the new media, but I think that, as you said, it's a lottery. But anyhow, I mean, this profession is, as you know, I guess it's a very tough profession. So, I mean, mm-hmm. A lot of people try, few succeed. Among those who succeed, very few keep on doing it, and I mean, I guess it's the essence of this strange profession.
I would say to kind of like go directly to the fact that it's not realistic to survive as an independent filmmaker. Although I recently graduated, but I think that first of all, I wouldn't think of it like as my only job, I would say. I still don't have a proper job because I'm kind of like traveling around with the film, but I think that in my experience and what I've learned and what I want to do would be maybe teaching or having like something that will give me stability because, you know, as you said, it's gonna be ups and downs, the whole, you know, journey, I think. And nowadays, how personally I finance my film, it was through different diverse kind of how do you call it, like sources of money. One was Indiegogo, for example, so the other one was a grant but came through Columbia University, the other one, you know, private people. And I think that that's kind of like the way that we have to do it nowadays. No one will, I don't think a private investor would put money for a short film, but sometimes if you hook it like with a feature, people will be a bit more interested. But I think that, yeah, and me as an international, you know, foreign filmmaker, the world, I think, is opening up to co-productions. And I think that in feature films, independent feature films, no one would make nowadays a film outside the States without having another country as a co-producer. So, and that's how we're making our features in Latin America and Europe, I would say. So I think that, yeah, that's gonna be, and I think that that's gonna happen in this country very soon also.
We have time for one more question.
I have one more thing to say about that. In that, like, well, my story is not very similar to many who make shorts. So my story is that, like, I approached my professor to make this film, and fortunately, still being in school, I kind of took it as an opportunity to learn and make, you know, just a short, tiny, the film is 3 minutes and 53 seconds. And so we sort of took it as like a learning exercise to play with the medium of shorts and also play with the medium of animation. And secondly, when you're beginning, like me, if you make a short film that sucks, then you only waste a month or two. But if you are a 20-year-old filmmaker and you make a feature and it sucks, you wasted like 6 or 7 months of your life. And then you can just go from there. And then, you know, we made the film kind of ironically, like, it's going to be a viral hit. It's going to be on Vimeo. But we were kind of being pessimistic. When you boil it down, it was kind of a learning experience. And then it turned out to be such a sweet little tiny film that we were like, oh, what the heck? Let's submit it to some film festivals. And then we found out that a couple of people liked it. And yeah, and then it's a great way to make friends with selection committees for film festivals and for that day that you, you know, you come out with a feature. Doesn't hurt. And then, so, I don't know, play with shorts until you get it right. Couldn't hurt. Use it as a learning exercise. I don't know how many of y'all are still in school, though, but.
Just quickly, I guess we'll just wrap up with, I know Lisanne's film will be on HBO this month or next month?
Next year.
But what for the rest of you, what is the future for these shorts? Any news on that you want to share?
The Jean Nouvel film's in a few film festivals. It's Chicago, Savannah, and Milan. So it'll be a festival thing. And then maybe we'll make it into a feature.
Cool. Nadav?
Yeah, so actually the film premiered in Cannes and it's gonna be commercially released in France, in French-speaking territories, how they call it? France, Belgium, Canada, etc. And then, of course, film festivals. I'm going from here to Montreal and etc.
Great.
We have a screening. Two screenings coming up, Twin Cities Film Festival, which is my hometown. I was so pumped to get in there. And then the International Film Festival in Manhattan, which both of those are at the end of this month, near the end of October. And then, my brother and I, who animated it, were planning on animating all sorts of other non-fictional stories and kind of turning them into this visually almost fictional sort of representation. We're having a lot of fun with that right now.
Francisca, you?
Yeah, so the short premiere at Telluride, then we went to Toronto, then here, and from we only know now that we're going to Warsaw Film Festival, and in terms of the American festivals, we are kind of like, we don't know yet the next one. I mean, a couple are coming, but we're not 100% sure.
And you've got your feature in pre-production or just early stages?
They are both in development right now. And I think that the one that I will shoot in Chile will be faster. Shooting in third world countries is like cheaper and faster. So I'll do that. And the other one that is for here, we don't know yet. It's maybe 2, maybe 3 years.
Great.
Yeah.
Francisca Alegria, Nadav Lapid, Lisanne Skyler, Matt Tyrnauer, and Lewie Kloster. Thank you so much for being here. And I'm Jude Dry from IndieWire.